emerged after Tokyo, Willis and I met at a conference, and we started to discuss the proliferation of practice theories across managerial subdomains. Also started to discuss how we used practice-based orientations in our own research to explore very different empirical phenomena. And what we experienced was that practice theories seemed to offer a sort of a common own research, as in these different subdomains. So after vast discussions, we decided that this idea might be of interest to others than us as well. And it seems like these different subdomains benefit from talking to each other. So many subdomains of management studies have some kind of a connection hub or a platform where they can share ideas in the sense of practice theoretic studies. And that was also our experience when we discussed our own research. And apparently we are not the only ones who have had this idea, because I think this conference has really witnessed that there's been a lot of attempts to make cross-proliferation of practice theoretic perspectives with other perspectives, which is great, I think. So the aim of this symposium is basically to take stock on the current status of practice-based studies in these various subdomains. And by taking stock, we mean that what is the current stage of development in these different subdomains? And then also to move forward. And by moving forward, we mean we consider that it becomes a matter of making these different subdomains talk together. And engage in a cross-domain dialogue. So this is the aim of the symposium, to take stock and move forward. And with this short introduction, I will hand it over to you, Yulisa.
Thank you. So now it's my pleasure to welcome and introduce the panel of distinguished speakers. So I'm very happy to have, we are very happy to have Joseph Berlin from Northeastern University here with us. Joey has published extensively in the field of leadership. Just recently, he edited a book entitled Leadership as Practice. So as an expert in that field, Joey will represent Leadership as Practice. Then William Gardner from Babson College. He published numerous books, book chapters, and journal articles in the field of entrepreneurship. He made tremendous contribution by considering entrepreneurship as a social activity. So we are very happy that William Gardner will represent entrepreneurship as practice. Natalia Levina from New York University, Stern School of Business. Natalia is very well known for her research on technology development and online platforms, which she studied from the practice theoretical perspective of Pierre Bourdieu. So we are very happy to have you too. And then I'm very pleased to also introduce to you Richard Whittington from University of Oxford. So Richard is one of the founding fathers and mothers, maybe as well, of strategy as practice. So he published the first article on this topic in 1996, in which he introduced an entire new understanding of strategy and strategy research in general. But he was also among the first to call for a cross-domain dialogue to sort of bring together domains interested in the practice turn. So each of the panelists will briefly discuss and reflect on the practice turn in their respective domains, which means they will talk about the opportunities, drawing on practice theories, but also the limitations. And then we have the honor to hear Davide Nicolini, here reflecting on the practice turn in management studies in general, more broadly, and also, but also discussing how we can bring those conversations together. So for those who don't know, shouldn't know Davide, he's a professor of organization studies at Warwick Business School. He made a tremendous contribution to organization studies and management studies by making practice theory more accessible for empirical research. And as a practice theorist himself, he's also interested in further developing practice theories. So after that, we will open up the discussion to you, to the audience, to give you also a chance to engage in this dialogue across domains about the practice term. And with this, I would like to hand over to you, Drew, who will kick off the panel.
I think I need the mic, other than, like you, some of the socials that we attended last night, but do you all hear me? Okay. I'd probably speak on behalf of the panelists. We'd like to really thank Violeta, Casper, and Tokyo for having us all together like this to try to learn from each other, especially by triangulating our various perspectives. So, and by the way, thank you all for attending at this hour in the morning as well. I think for me, the idea would be by combining courses, maybe together, we might be able to shift the focus a little bit from standard nomothetic to more constructionist approaches to social phenomena. So, my contribution, as you know, is from the leadership as practice perspective. So, I'd start by saying that we do not view leadership as emanating from people, or from the traits or heroics of individuals. We see it as arriving from everyday practice. We like to say that when social processes change the trajectory of the flow of practices, or change the turning points in the spaces between people, then there's a chance that leadership may be going on. Why would we do this? Well, from a constructionist perspective, if we can understand and reflect on our practices, hey, then we can change it according to our mutual interests. So one of our mantras in leadership as practice, I'll use the term LAP, is that to find leadership, let's look to the practices within which it is occurring. So just a couple of foundations for us before then looking at its contribution potentially. It's a processual rather than entitative approach. So what are entities? I mean, they're stable and controllable things, right? Like subject to subject relations and so forth. But the contrast processes suggest that people and their socio-material elements, their agency, all themselves co-constitute as this unfolding set of fluid practices. But this particular approach does have a problem with agency, doesn't it? At least standard agency, if agency means making a difference in the world by transforming structure or mobilizing social action. Because typically we think that in such agency there's an influencer and an influencee, right? Leader and a follower. But from the LAP perspective, we think that people are already in motion. I mean, they don't necessarily need someone from on high to kind of thrust them into action. So my colleagues, Linda Buchan and Barbara Simpson, in a play on words, they refer to this as inflowence, F-L-O-W-E-N-C-E. What we're talking about is movement within the practices. Think of it as like a jazz improvisation. You know, someone might begin a variation on a theme, and someone else might take it from there and so on, right? Well, does it really pay to pay attention to who's the influencer and who's the influencee? Or are we more interested in the overall flow of the practice? And is that characteristic of your settings and your practices? So, a couple of opportunities, since this is our focus here on the panel. First, within LAP, some trends and opportunities. We have the opportunity now to explore the collective level. we have an opportunity to focus on the other and a chance to study leadership at multiple interacting levels, from the individual level, say looking at the embodied self, all the way over to the macro level, looking at institutional arrangements, for example. And we have an opportunity to look at process-oriented and narrative methods, as well as multimodal methodologies, using video, using audio, using photo technology, or what sometimes we refer to as the performance research. Other trends and opportunities, exploring intersubjective experience as the basis of agency. Rather than study linearity, consider recursiveness. The results of one practice becomes the resource for the next practice, or it's the same practice. Or rather than relying on expertise, make meaning together with meaning not just an input to the practice, but a process and an output. Well, maybe I'll make one other comment. There may be some conditions where, there are opportunities for expanding practice. For example, looking at structures that are amenable to more leadership as practice approaches. Say, that emphasize lateral relations rather than vertical relations as a transmission of instructions. Okay. Within the wider leadership domain, some of these I pointed out already, but essentially we're interested in a participant-oriented practice where perhaps the manager in charge encourages a dispersion of control. And of course, jazz as a great metaphor for us, where it leads to a range of critical questions. Particularly, I really love this dilemma of how we can promote both virtuosity and coherence at the same time. And then contributions to leadership development. I know you're all familiar with Daniel Kahneman, the famous cognitive scientist. And during the war, in his team's evaluation of leadership traits, they found that their assessment was little better than chance when compared to subsequent performance as evaluated or rated by commanders in the field. So what does this suggest? Well, maybe we shouldn't take people out of their practice and put them into their leadership training. Maybe we need to bring leadership into the practice setting where it is occurring. Well, how do we do that? Well, I think we have to catch people in the act of being themselves in their lived experience. Maybe throw in a dilemma to see if they can learn their way out. But add a touch of reflective dialogue. What do I mean by reflective dialogue? Let them explore intersubjective differences. Let them make on-the-spot disruptions of meaning and then reframe. Right? Let them explore inferences and assumptions. The outcomes from this LAP approach, I think, are multiple. I'll just point out a few here. People develop a peripheral awareness of one another. They develop a humility to see that whatever they do is based upon the contribution of others, and they look for new ways of understanding rather than just agreement or disagreement.